All right, it's 0-0, and everybody's got a smile on their face, right? Yeah? I don't know. Some of y'all are fighting it. I'm just kidding. How are you doing today? All right. Did y'all see all the booths out there? Did you sign up for something? Okay. Well, they'll be there for a while, so you be sure and you listen what God's telling you to go sign up for and be a part. I'm really, really excited because we've got almost everyone back in the choir, so that is a hallelujah, and I'm very glad and excited about that. And if you want to join the choir, the summer is the best time because that's when we do all the really fun music. Not that the other isn't fun, but that's when we kind of just let our hair down a little bit and we do some different things. So if you want to come and try us out, we meet every Sunday at 5 o'clock, and we go till about 6, and we just have a lot of fun, so we would love for you to join us. So you're doing all right this morning, all right? Nobody had to swim. I think our roads are all finally cleared off, and that's a great thing. Well, we want to welcome those of you who are watching on Facebook. We hope that you are having a blessed day as well. Now, did you notice something else? No tape, no tape, no tape. That was really fun. The choir helped take it down. I got to karate chop some of them. It was really fun. But without further ado, I want to welcome you to First Baptist Church. If you're new here, we want to welcome you especially. And if you, everybody stand up real quick. Everybody stand up. Okay, if you're new here, sit down. If you're new, sit down. All right. See, usually we do it the other way. Isn't that better? Now you kind of just feel. So we have several that are new with us. So y'all get around and y'all give them a hug all around their neck if that's okay with them. And I don't know, can we do that now, Scott? No? Okay, I am. All right, y'all have a seat. Are y'all ready to worship? I mean, that's why you came, right? You came here because we love God. And like I prayed with the choir, words are cheap. We can say we love Him all day long, but if our actions don't show it, then it's not love. We're just a clanging cymbal, right? So we are going to worship Him today with all of our heart and our soul and our mind and everything that He created us to be. So, you got comfortable? Let's stand back up. Oh, worship the King. Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing His wonderful love, our shield and defender. Pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise, Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the light, it streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, and sweetly our Redeemer and our friend. Psalm 117 says, "Praise the Lord, all you nations. Extol Him, all you peoples. For great is His love towards us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord." Amen. Let's have a seat. During this time of reflection, I know that in the 11 o'clock service, we're going to be recognizing our graduating seniors, and we do have several. And I would just like for us right now to lift up our students in prayer. I'd like for us to pray for God's protection around them as they leave and go off into the world, because we all remember what it was like to go off into the world, right? And so let's lift them up today. Let's ask God to be with them and to be real for them, and that they would continue in their faith that they have started since they've been here. So let's pray together.
Acknowledge that you are here with us in this place today. We are thankful for the newness of spring, the transitions that seem to be occurring in our society now, moving more towards opening up, and we ask God that you would keep safe as people safe as we move in this direction. But Lord, help us to reconnect with one another, and especially with your purposes for us and for this church, in this community, and in the world. We pray, Lord, for those who are graduating today, whether it be from high school or college or other educational endeavors. We ask, God, that you would bless them, that you would reveal yourself to them, speak to them, so that they can follow you in the days and years to come. We ask, God, that you would speak to us this day and call forth from us a response that would make us more like your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. It is for his sake that we are here. It is for his sake that we worship. We ask that you would make us more like him. We love you. We trust you. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name.
Just a little talk with Jesus. I love that song. Psalm 119. Blessed are those whose ways are blameless, who walk according to the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his statutes and seek him with all their heart, not just part, but all. They do no wrong, but follow his ways. You have laid down precepts that are to be fully obeyed. Oh, that my ways were steadfast in obeying your decrees. Then I would not be put to shame when I consider all your commands. I will praise you with an upright heart. And as I learn your righteous laws, I will obey your decrees. Do not utterly forsake me. Christ is the solid rock that we stand on. And when we stand, we're obeying because his word is in our heart and we're hearing and we're doing. Let's stand together and let's sing. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. The solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. Psalm 85:12 says, the Lord of hosts, happy is the person who trusts in you. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. But to what? Trust and obey. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. Let us do his good. With us still, and with all who will trust and obey, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at his happy.
to trust and obey. He is here.
Lord Jesus, I do thank you for being here with us this morning. Lord, I thank you that your word is what we rely on, that your word is what we stand on. So, Lord, I just pray, Lord, in just a few minutes as Pastor Scott comes, Lord, I pray for him. I pray for protection around him. I pray, Lord, that you would preach through him mightily and boldly, Lord, and may our hearts be open to hear what it is that you want to say to us. So, Lord, we thank you for this time of gathering. We thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy, for it's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Second Ephesians verse 8 says, "For by grace are you saved, and that by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, so that no one can boast." A brand new creation.
grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all my sin. Grace, marvelous grace, flows from above with infinite love. Marvelous grace.
Thanks, Tim. Good morning. All right, we're in a moment. I'll be reading from the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 15, if you want to look with me there in your Bibles, 1 Samuel 15. For months now, we've been talking about these books of history in the Old Testament, specifically 1 Samuel, and I've been talking about how they teach us about this legacy of faith. You and I received this legacy of faith from those who've gone before us, the way that they understood and responded to the presence of God, and the Word of God creates this legacy that they've passed down from to the next generation. And I also am passing on a legacy of faith, whether I realize it or not. And so the way that I understand and respond to the presence in the Word of God is passing on a legacy of faith for those who will come behind me. It's my prayer that they will find me and all of us faithful. And so I want to pay attention to what's recorded for us in books like 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel so that I can understand my own experience and respond to the Lord appropriately. Now, we've skipped over chapters 13 and 14 because I've decided it's probably not in my best interest to read all of those chapters from the pulpit on a Sunday morning. People unintentionally get very sleepy. And let's don't do that. And so we're going to just summarize. In chapter 13, what happens is that, Saul has just become king of Israel, and the people have affirmed him and all of that, and Samuel has given them all of the appropriate warnings about the meaning of their rebellion against God and their sin against God, and the people repent, and everything is good. And so Saul gathers Israel's armies together in chapter 13 to fight a Philistine army that was much larger and better equipped. And Saul decides he's going to offer this sacrifice to God in order to curry God's favor. He thinks that by offering this act of worship, God will be pleased with that worship and will give Israel the victory, even though they're facing this overwhelming force in the Philistine army. And so he doesn't wait for Samuel. His instructions are, before he makes the sacrifice, he's supposed to wait for Samuel. They're surrounded by the Philistines. His people are getting anxious. Saul decides that it's in everybody's best interest if he doesn't wait for Samuel. And so he offers the sacrifices by himself. And God is not pleased, and through the prophet Samuel, he tells Saul that there is not any chance for him to have any more of his family sitting on the throne of Israel. He's lost his dynasty. His boys will die violent deaths. And so, very discouraging for Saul, but in chapter 14, the story shifts to Saul's son, Jonathan, who's the second in line, or in line to take the throne of Israel. And we see how in the face of this overwhelming Philistine army, Jonathan acts boldly and with God's help, rallies the Israelite army, and God gives them victory against the Philistines. Saul is so pleased at their victory that he declares a fast to honor himself and God. You know, he includes himself in that. And because of this fast, they lose the opportunity to pursue the Philistine army and defeat them once and for all. And he lets them get away while he's declaring this fast in honor of himself and God. He also says that in the fast, anybody who breaks the fast is going to be killed. Well, it just so happens that his son Jonathan didn't know about the fast. And he finds some honey on the ground and he eats it. And suddenly Saul's own son, the heir to the throne, is in danger of losing his life. And you can guess what happened. Saul says, well, I didn't mean it, you know. So it's all good. So Saul fails in his opportunity to rid Israel of his of this devastatingly dangerous enemy. So in chapter 15, after a time of having the people reject God as their king and of Saul making some questionable decisions in his own life, God is now going to reject Saul as the king of Israel. It's a heartbreaking account that we'll look at today. I have just one point this morning. I know that causes your heart to rejoice. But here's the point. God wants the kind of obedience from his people that shows they have removed themselves from the throne of their lives and have made the Lord their true king. So the issue, as always, revolves around who is the authority in our lives. Is it God? And we're all going to say, yes, of course it's God. But remember, in matters like this, the truth is never revealed in what we say. The truth is always revealed in what we do and how we live. And there can be a disconnect between what we profess to believe and then how we actually live our lives. And so God is going to address this reality through the prophet Samuel today as he addresses King Saul. So let's look in 1 Samuel chapter 15. I'll start reading at verse 1. Samuel said to Saul, "I am the one the Lord your king, let's start over. Samuel said to Saul, "I am the one the Lord made." What is going on here? All right. Let's try this again. "I am the one the Lord sent to anoint you king over his people Israel. So listen now to the message from the Lord. This is what the Lord Almighty says. I will punish the Amalekites for what they did to Israel when they waylaid them as they came up from Egypt. Now go, attack the Amalekites and totally destroy everything that belongs to them. Do not spare them. Put to death men and women, children and infants, cattle and sheep, camels and donkeys." So Saul summoned the men and mustered them at Telaim, 200,000 foot soldiers and 10,000 men from Judah. Saul went to the city of Amalek and set an ambush in the ravine. Then he said to the Kenites, "Go away, leave the Amalekites so that I do not destroy you along with them. For you showed kindness to all the Israelites when they came up out of Egypt." So the Kenites moved away from the Amalekites. Then Saul attacked the Amalekites all the way from Havilah to Shur to the east of Egypt. He took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive, and all his people he totally destroyed with the sword. But Saul and the army spared Agag and the best of the sheep and cattle, the fat calves and lambs, everything that was good. These they were unwilling to destroy completely, but everything that was despised and weak they totally destroyed. Then the word of the Lord came to Samuel, "I am grieved that I have made Saul king, because he has turned away from me and has not carried out my instructions." Samuel was troubled, and he cried out to the Lord all that night. Early in the morning, Samuel got up and went to meet Saul, but he was told, "Saul has gone to Carmel. There he has set up a monument in his own honor and has turned and gone on down to Gilgal." When Samuel reached him, Saul said, "The Lord bless you. I have carried out the Lord's instructions." But Samuel said, "What then is this bleating of sheep in my ears? What is this lowing of cattle that I hear?" And Saul answered, "The soldiers brought them from the Amalekites. They spared the best of the sheep and cattle to sacrifice to the Lord your God. But we totally destroyed the rest. Stop, Samuel said to Saul. Let me tell you what the Lord said to me last night. Tell me, Saul replied. Samuel said, although you were once small in your own eyes, did you not become the head of the tribes of Israel? The Lord anointed you king over Israel. And he sent you on a mission saying, go and completely destroy those wicked people, the Amalekites. Make war on them until you have wiped them out. Why did you not obey the Lord? Why did you pounce on the plunder and do evil in the eyes of the Lord? But I did obey the Lord, Saul said. I went on the mission the Lord assigned me. I completely destroyed the Amalekites and brought back Agag, their king. The soldiers took sheep and cattle from the plunder, the best of what was devoted to God, in order to sacrifice them to the Lord your God at Gilgal. But Samuel replied, does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the voice of the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams. For rebellion is like the sin of divination, and arrogance like the evil of idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. Then Saul said to Samuel, I have sinned. I violated the Lord's command and your instructions. I was afraid of the people, and so gave in to them. Now I beg you, forgive my sin. And come back with me so that I may worship the Lord. But Samuel said to him, I will not go back with you. You have rejected the word of the Lord, and the Lord has rejected you as king over Israel. As Samuel turned to leave, Saul caught hold of the hem of his robe and tore it. Samuel told him, the Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you today and has given it to one of your neighbors, to one better than you. He who is the glory of Israel does not lie or change his mind, for he is not a man that he should change his mind. Saul replied, I have sinned, but please honor me before the elders of my people and before Israel. Come back with me so that I may worship the Lord your God. So Samuel went back with Saul, and Saul worshiped the Lord. Then Samuel said, bring me Agag, king of the Amalekites. Agag came to him confidently, thinking, surely the bitterness of death is past. But Samuel said, as your sword has made women childless, so will your mother be childless among women. And Samuel put Agag to death before the Lord at Gilgal. Then Samuel left for Ramah, but Saul went up to his home in Gibeah of Saul. Until the day Samuel died, he did not go to see Saul again, though Samuel mourned for him. And the Lord was grieved that he had made Saul king over Israel. All right, there are several things that happen here in the text. It's important that we understand what's going on in order to have a sense of what God is saying to us today. So we see that God tells King Saul to bring God's judgment on a people who harmed Israel long ago. And although God's instructions are specific, Saul and his soldiers disobey the word of the Lord. In the text, Samuel goes to King Saul with the word of the Lord. He's to destroy the Amalekites as an instrument of God's judgment on them because they had not helped Israel. And you can go back and read about that. That's in Exodus chapter 17. Where God pronounced judgment on the Amalekites for the way that they treated Moses and Israel as they were on their way to the promised land. So God had promised them then that he would bring justice to the Amalekites. Now he was going to make good on his word through Saul and through the Israelite army. The Amalekites were guilty, and in God's eyes, they all had to die. Men, women, children, infants, livestock, all their possessions were to be destroyed. Now, this kind of violence has a special word, has a special term, and it's describing just a few occasions in the Old Testament that something like this was practiced where everybody was destroyed and all of their possessions and no one was shown mercy. And if you want to find out more about it and you have questions about how God could do something like that, ask your life group leaders today. They're going to explain all that to you. I, however, am not. This kind of violence was reserved for people who had come under the Lord's severest judgment. These were terrible, heinous people. And I got news for you. Does any group of people in the history of the world, in any place in the world, deserve mercy? No. The fact that God gives any of us mercy is miraculous. So we need to understand that no one is innocent here in this world because of sin. And so serving as the instrument of God's holy judgment was a solemn occasion. This was not typical warfare. This was God's judgment meted out on a terrible people. And so the soldiers of Israel were not to profit personally from this battle. They were not to collect plunder, nor were they to collect slaves. Everybody, everything was to be destroyed and given over to the Lord. And it tells us in the text that Saul's attack was a success. However, Saul spared Agag, the Amalekite king, and his soldiers kept the best of the livestock for themselves. This was flagrant disregard for the Lord's clear commands. And he's going to try to justify it later. We'll talk about that. But keep in mind that self-serving, selective obedience to the Word of God is dangerous. Without fail. Next, we see that God and Samuel grieve that Saul is king of Israel because Saul's self-centered disregard of the word of the Lord. They grieve. God tells Samuel he's grieving that he made Saul king. The only other occasion where God uses this language to say that he's grieving over people's actions was when he observed the wickedness of humanity that led to the flood in Genesis chapter 6 and story. You remember Noah and the ark? Yeah, at that time, God said, I'm grieved over the way these people are living. And it means literally that God was deeply concerned. He suffers emotional pain in this occasion regarding the choices that Saul had made of his own free will. Saul had failed to follow God's commands completely, and there would be consequences. And when God expresses this to Samuel, Samuel grieves all night. He wrestles with the Lord over this reality. And then he leaves in the morning to deal with Saul. However, Saul was not where he was supposed to be. And when Samuel asks, where's the king? They tell him that the king was off setting up a monument in his own honor to commemorate his victory, and Samuel then goes down to Gilgal to find Saul there, and Saul is there with the intention of using the captured animals to worship the Lord. But I want you to notice, after the battle, who did Saul honor before he honored God? Himself. Himself. Next, we see that instead of taking responsibility for his sin, King Saul rationalizes his disobedience and shifts the blame to others. So Samuel arrives at Gilgal. Saul greets him in an ironic way. Hey, Lord bless you. You know, all is good. And then Saul immediately proceeds to brag about his obedience. I did everything the Lord told me to do. And Samuel's response, really? What am I hearing then? Is that your cattle? That come from your house? And Saul, I think, immediately recognizes his error, and he says, no, you know, the soldiers in the army spared the best of the sheep and cattle. It was their fault. Yeah. And in verse 24, he says that he was afraid of the people and gave in to them and did what they wanted, and that's why they collected the cattle. It wasn't me. Who was it? Those people, they're the ones that need God's punishment now. And then he rationalizes his disobedience. Nobody had done anything wrong, really. I mean, these animals were not killed in the battle. That's true. but their slaughter was only delayed so that God might be glorified now as we offer the sacrifice here to the Lord your God. He's deceiving himself. And I want you to realize there's no end to our ability to deceive ourselves and explain away our sinful rebellion and disobedience. You and I are experts at explaining why we are not doing the word of the Lord. Unfortunately, instead of destroying wickedness, which was what God told him to do, King Saul increased wickedness by doing evil in the eyes of the Lord. Samuel tells him, next, we see that obeying the word of the Lord is more important to God than all our religious rituals and acts of worship. Let me say that again. Obeying the word of the Lord is more important to God than all our religious rituals and acts of worship. So Samuel speaks the truth and pronounces God's judgment. Obedience, he says literally, obedience surpasses sacrifice. The truth is reinforced, and he says, to hear, to listen to the word of the Lord is better than offering to God the fat of rams. And don't make any mistake here. Clearly, sacrifice was an important part of Old Testament worship, but it was never to be done as a substitute for obeying God's word. And then Samuel reveals Saul's motive. He says that Saul rebelled against the word of the Lord because of the arrogance in his heart. And that's the problem. Who's in charge? Who has the authority? Who reigns from the throne of our lives? And for Saul, it wasn't God. Who was it? It was Saul. It was Saul. And here's the truth. If I want to have a real, vital, life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ, then I will have to deal with my rebellion against God. I'm going to have to deal with the fact that God or Christ is not reigning from the throne of my life, that I am. And that I have to come to terms with that. God calls me to be conformed to His word. He calls me to be conformed to His ways and to His character. This is the work of the Spirit, but it's also my work as I yield my life each day to God's Spirit, to His Word, to be shaped into the likeness of Christ. It's an active partnership that I have with the Lord, and it's one I too often check out of. It's easier, I think, or more desirable for me to do what I want. And when I live that way, I'm wrong. Always, always. Now, I want you to think about this. If you tell someone something on a need-to-know basis, you only tell that person the facts he or she needs to know at the time they need to know them and nothing more. You get this concept? Are you familiar with a need-to-know basis? Those of you who work, especially in the healthcare profession, this is a really big deal in record-keeping and what's told people and all of that. Some people are on a need-to-know basis, but we're really familiar with this in military, and those of you who are who came up through the military, you'll remember your experience in armed forces was that you didn't get to ask a lot of questions. You know, you were given orders. And were they suggestions? No, generally not. You had to follow them. Or there were consequences for you. We see this also in every government operation that exists, in cases of espionage. And you keep in mind that there is this larger mission, right? And you have a part in it. And everything depends on you doing your small part of this overall mission. If you will just do that, then we're going to win. But when you go out of bounds and you start messing around with things you have no business messing around with, that's when the wheels come off and all will be lost. Are you following me there? Right. So what I've found is that my family works much the same way. And I've created this visual to illustrate what I'm talking about. So in my family, that's too big. I want to know what's going on. So I ask, what's going on? And everything that's actually going on is in the blue. And the yellow represents everything that I might possibly know about what is going on because of my clearance level. I'm the father. And everybody agrees that I'm entitled to know a certain amount about everything that is going on. Granted, I don't get to know everything, but I get to know everything that's in the yellow, right? Nobody disputes that. Now, that doesn't mean I will get that information because I am on a need-to-know basis. So the red represents what I actually need to know. And if I will just stay in my lane, and if I don't ask questions, everything will be fine. However, if I try to learn something else that I don't need to know at that moment, there's going to be trouble. Is this true for your family as well? Right, so let's say, for instance, that my family is planning a surprise party for me, like a birthday party. I might ruin everything by asking questions, by thinking independently, and especially by not following directions. I'm simply supposed to be at a certain place at a certain time. Yes, but what about... Be at a certain place at a certain time. And if I will do that, everything will be fine. The problem is, that's not in my nature. And the Bible describes a similar kind of reality in my relationship with God. God has all these vast divine purposes that He is working out on the stage of human history as well as in my life. And I cannot grasp or comprehend the enormity of what God is doing at all places and at all times or even in my own life. But God has told me what I need to know right now. And when He tells me what I need to know right now, He invites me to do two things. He invites me to trust Him in all things and to obey Him in all things. If I will do that, my testimony is everything tends to be okay in the long run. The problem is I don't do this. I don't stay in my lane. Whether it's my pride or my arrogance or my fears or my anxieties, I tend to neither trust God nor obey God in all things. My tendency is to do what I want, to do what I think is best, to make judgment calls, and to act on knee-jerk reactions that I regret. Later, I go my own way. The Bible calls this sin. And sin always ends in disaster. For me, and for everyone who knows me, it's a mess. Now, because God is clear, I'm supposed to trust Him and obey Him, and because it's true that I tend not to do either one, does that mean I am doomed to be rejected as Saul was? Is my situation hopeless because I'm a rebel and I tend to want and pursue what I want? I want to give you some hope today. In your Bibles, look over in the book of 1 John, chapter 1. I'm going to read this and then I'll be done, pretty much. In 1 John, chapter 1, we'll see an example of how the New Testament both affirms what Samuel tells Saul about obedience, but it also gives us reason to hope in Christ. 1 John chapter 1, I'm going to start reading at verse 5. John writes, "This is the message we have heard from Him and declare to you. God is light. In Him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with Him yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light, as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, His Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make Him out to be a liar, and His word has no place in our lives. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. We know that we have come to know him if we obey his commands. The man who says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must walk as Jesus did. Dear friends, I'm not writing you a new command, but an old one, which you have had since the beginning. This old command is the message you have heard, yet I am writing you a new command. Its truth is seen in him and you, because the darkness is passing and the true light is already shining. Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates his brother is still in darkness. Whoever loves his brother lives in the light, and there is nothing in him to make him stumble. But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks around in the darkness. He does not know where he is going because the darkness has blinded him. There are two essential truths here regarding my rebellion against God. Here's the first one. I cannot have any kind of relationship with God if I do not allow his word to be the sole authority that shapes my life. And I can't rescue you from this truth. No amount of worship or ritual can save me from my rebellious disregard of God's word. I cannot be the authority that shapes my life. My opinions, my perceptions, my desires, I have to conform my life to the Word of God. I cannot conform God's Word to my life. The second truth, however, is this. When I realize that I have failed at making God's Word the sole authority of my life, and believe me, I will fail sooner or later, I am to confess my sin and receive mercy through Jesus Christ. I fail at making God's word the authority of my life. I think I know what is best for me and especially for you, and I act in my own interests according to my own understanding. And it is a mercy when God helps me to see that I'm making my own way instead of following the Lord's way. And when I realize this, rather than despair, I should turn to Christ. And the New Testament tells us that the death and resurrection of Jesus means that God forgives my sin. The price for my rebellion, the penalty, has already been paid. And so a new and different kind of life is possible. But I cannot kid myself about my sin any longer. I have to admit it. And I have to take it to the one who offers me not just forgiveness, but redemption and new life. Now, to all my fellow rebels out there, do you believe that a new life is possible for you? I have this video I want us to watch, and then we'll be done.
Tells me not to look back.
Because there's nothing there to see.
I am not my mistakes.
He is
knows what is ahead, and walk away with all regrets erased by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Every day I'm given a clean slate.
A clean slate? I get a clean slate.
And the news is just that good. And it is contrary to our instincts or maybe to the culture, what we expect. But listen, that repentance and regret that compels us to Christ leads to a new beginning. That is grace. And that is the foundation of our hope. My regret is to compel me in repentance to the one who makes a new beginning for me. So this morning, I want to invite you to do two things. Today, I invite you to begin or renew today a relationship with God in which I give to God and His Word the sole authority to shape, your life. Begin or renew that relationship today. Who reigns in your life? I hope that today you'll get the opportunity, or you'll make the most of the opportunity, to get that straight. The second thing I would invite you to do is to confess to God your failure to make Him and His Word the sole authority to shape your life. Then I invite you to repent and turn to Christ for the grace to begin again. Confess, repent, return, and then experience a new beginning. In a moment, I'm going to pray, and then Marcy's going to come and lead us in this time of response. And while we're singing, I hope that you will respond to the word of the Lord as He speaks to you today. While we're singing, the altar would be open if you'd like to come and kneel down here and pray, or if you want to talk to me, I'll be standing down here. And then when the service is over, I'm going to be around somewhere. I don't know where, because the foyer's awfully crowded, but I'm going to be around. I'd love to talk to you about what God is saying to you today. But this is our time to respond. So let's pray and then we'll sing. Lord, today, pray that you'd give us the grace to understand who reigns in the universe and in our own hearts. And Lord, if the truth reveals today that I'm the one who's in control, I pray, Lord, that you would save me and spare me. Have mercy on me. And in my regret, I bring my rebellion to you and I repent. And I trust that your word is true as I repent and as I turn to you, as I return to you, and as I lay my sin aside and walk in a new way, that I will experience not just forgiveness, but also redemption and new beginnings. King Saul couldn't face the reality of his own sin. He deflected and explained, "Save me from that today so that I could experience a new beginning." And may that be true for all of those who've come to worship you today. Show them the truth. Guide them to repentance and to redemption, Lord. For your sake, for your glory, make them new this day. And so may your will be done as we respond to you. And we love you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with me while we sing?
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence. I surrender all. I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power. Let thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Amen. Brother Steve, you come up and close us in prayer.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, as we look around, we see this church is just back to normal. We thank you for bringing them back. Thank you for Marcy and the choir as you minister to us through music, and thank you for the Holy Spirit that was here with Scott Jones now as he brought this message. And we just know that we want to do your will in everything that we do. Be with us. Be with this nation now, as we know this nation seems like it's going in the wrong direction, but we know that you're in control. So we thank you for that. And thank you for all our police officers that are out there. It looks like their lives are in danger every time they go to work, and just keep them safe. Thank you for this day, and thank you for everything. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.
All right. Okay, family. You don't have to hold hands or nothing. I'm not going to make you do that. But let's sing one last song together, and then I will be outside at my little booth if you want to come and join choir. All right. Everybody got that? Okay. All right. Here we go. I'm so glad of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joint heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm part of this family, the family of God. Amen. God bless you. And we will see you again, if not this week, next. No, actually, I won't. I'm going on vacation. I will not be here next week.